We have quite a treat in store for you now. Lightning talks from some of our students in the Media Lab and across campus and from our Morningside Academy of Design. So think you're all ready, right? Without further ado, our student lightning talks, I think Vald Danry is gonna kick us off. Welcome, come on up.
Hey everyone, so my name is Valdemar Danry. I am a graduate student in Patty Maas's Fluid Interfaces group. And this is a photo of me with a cat on my head. This didn't happen. This is generative AI, but hopefully it's fun. I don't hear a lot of people laughing, but cool. So one of the things that I think is really exciting about generative AI is when you are having systems that can make anything anywhere, the boundary between an idea and reality sort of disappears. And there's nowhere else, you know, where I think this idea is more exemplified than in the notorious MIT class, How to Make Almost Anything. This is a class where you're learning a lot of skills in a lot, like in a very short time, to build essentially anything. Build electronic systems, you know, robots, furniture, and things like that. But it's extremely hard to learn all of these skills in such a short amount of time. And you know, one thing is maybe generative AI can help us in this case. However, mostly, you know, these generative AI systems have just been used for ideation, creating websites, images and posters, and things that are mostly in your computer. But one thing we've been working at on in our lab is figuring out how can we go from, for instance, a text like salt shaker in the shape of an axolotl, and then actually have an AI system produce a design that can then turn into a real thing. So, you know, here is a video of 3D printing one of these AI-generated designs, and here is the physical output of it. But, you know, this is very small. We've also made things that are bigger. And this is something that you can actually see down in the on the ground floor here of the Media Lab. There's an installation that we've done taking a bunch of tableware that are AI generated and put them together. But what about other things, you know, than 3D printing things? So we also made this experiment where we tried to see, can we also bake a shoe made out of bread using these generative AI systems. Here you see the bread is coming out of the oven, the bread shoe. The final reveal from design to the actual bread shoe. Here we go. We did not wear it though. But there's also, you know, electronics is also extremely hard to do. So we've been working on a system where you just kind of give it an input, and then it figures out what do you need in order to, what do you need to connect in order to, you know, let's say you want to do something for your greenhouse. Gives you ideas, it tells you what to do, you know, you connect all the parts, and just based on what it says, it puts the code on your system, and you can just basically put it wherever you want, and then you have something measuring, let's say, your plant humidity level just by talking to an AI system. All right. So, you know, I think really think generative AI in the future might help us not just make things in our computers, but also things outside of our computer. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Cathy, and I'm also a PhD student in the Fluid Interfaces group. So to follow up on Vald's presentations, creating physical things using generative AI, I'm going to talk about creating virtual worlds using large language models. So even since the ancient time, we've been dreaming about a device like the holodeck from Star Trek that allows us to simulate any 3D objects and environments just at our fingertips. And with that, teachers can create physical simulations for the classrooms, or frontline workers can simulate a spread of wildfire ahead of rescue. But this is far from reality. And part of the reason is different from these generative images that I've created for the slide under a minute. It's exceedingly hard to create 3D objects and environments. Now with the latest generative AI tools, we have seen already creation of 3D objects, avatars, skyboxes, but they all mainly exist what I call visual space, meaning that you can't really manipulate them in real time. And also what they don't tell you is that it takes a lot of time and compute to generate them, but at the cost of limited compute, limited resolution and quality. So I'd like to introduce LLMR, which stands for Large Language Model for Mixed Reality. It is a framework that enables real-time creation and modification of 3D worlds and objects. So I will start by giving you a very simple example. So let's say I want to create a toy car, and it has to have this color, and I want to be able to drive it with my keys, WASD keys. You can do so by just simply speaking your ideas out. And once you're happy with your creation, you can take that and reload it in any environments, such as the moon terrain that you will see. So now this is a very, very simple example, but what about real life applications? So many of us maybe have tried to fix a machine or build IKEA furniture following a paper guide or try to phone a friend, but what if you can just follow an interactive 3D guide and allows you to ask questions like, am I doing the right thing? Or which button should I press? For storytellers, you can just generate animations by describing the behavior you want instead of manually rigging all of them. So taking from an example of a whale swimming to generate all these things on the right. And of course, a picture is worth 1,000 words. I want to be able to just draw things into existence, and you can just do so by saying, create me a magic paintbrush. And all of these examples can be done not only in virtual reality, but also in augmented reality, in wearing a HoloLens, or even connecting your mobile devices like the phones and watches. And we've given this tool to people to try and look at what they've been able to create under an hour of just trying this tool, such as creating a Walt Disneyland or creating a stunt dial. So I'll leave you with a question of what would you like to create if you have access to this tool? And actually, you can find me after the talk at the demo session to give your ideas a try. Thank you very much.
Nice save. Hi, my name is Kevin Dunnell. I'm a PhD student in the Viral Communications Lab under Andy Lippman, and I'm here today to talk about innovation with generative AI. So large language models have been a huge benefit for accessing and generating text-based information through a chat-based interface. The question that we're interested in asking, though, is can we expand this interface to visually explore idea spaces and inspire new ideas of our own? So Brett Victor and Jerome Bruner point out that higher channels of thought, like visual and interactive channels, are required for thinking about the unthinkable. Brett actually gave this talk here at the Media Lab about 10 years ago, and he pointed out how Francis and Crick conceptualized the double helix structure of DNA using physical models, which was pretty unheard of at the time in the field of chemistry. Our tool, Leighton Lab, helps us upgrade our channel of thinking in a similar way. So we've developed an automated pipeline that uses LLMs to semantically organize large data sets and surface relevant topics and subtopics. In the case of the Media Lab research, each project description is passed to an LLM to extract embeddings and relevant topics. So here's an example of Leighton Lab. In this tool, we can do a lot of things. So first, we can drill down from a very high topology view of a data set all the way to a specific piece of data, in this case, Media Lab projects, and understand more about that project. For data with a temporal aspect, we can actually scrub along this timeline on the bottom to understand how this data set evolves over time. And the tool supports search and synthesis. So a user here is searching in the top right corner, makeup that can detect an emotion. This is actually not a project that exists at the Media Lab today, but it takes us to a part of the map that is semantically similar to this idea. And so we're in this effective computing area. Users have the ability to select individual projects, add them to create a recipe, and actually synthesize a completely new research idea. This idea is not going to be perfect, but it's a basis for ideation and further conceptualization. So we can see here that there is a generated image, a title, and a description of the project, and we can see exactly what was used to generate this new project idea. Additionally, we support any image or text-based data set. So here we can see the US patent database. This is a subset of about 10,000 US patents. And in the same way, we have the exact same capabilities that I've been mentioning before. We've tested with data sets from other departments across MIT, from organizational data, from other member companies of the Media Lab, and we're still exploring more. Finally, this is a really new feature that we're just testing out now, but it's the ability to look at data sets in the context of other data sets. So we're seeking out ways to identify externalities with data sets and how that might influence another. So what you're seeing here in the red are Media Lab projects. In the blue are Microsoft research projects. So Microsoft, they uploaded all of their publicly facing blog posts on research efforts they're doing. And we can actually add an additional data set, which here I'm pulling in the E14, which is the venture fund here at the Media Lab. And so we can see about 60 different member companies or portfolio companies of the fund. And we're working with one of our member companies, Dell, on sort of identifying the life cycle of products and projects and trying to understand, can we map out how research projects are moving to patents and patents are moving to actual potentially companies. And so we can link out to understand more about each of these projects and companies in Layton Lab. In a recently published study that we conducted, we found that Layton Lab is significantly helpful in supporting insight extraction and mental support during the exploration process compared to traditional list-based methods like the Media Lab website today. And Layton Lab is completely public, so if you're interested in checking it out, head to this URL or scan the QR code. I'll be outside to answer any more questions you might have. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Manuel Cherep.
I'm Nikhil Singh, and we're from the Opera of the Future group, and we're here to talk to you about generating sounds, I think. Excellent. So generating sounds currently looks like this. Thanks to recent advances, let's say you have an idea for a bird, a sound of a bird. You can do something like formulate that as a prompt, like bird tweeting, and then send that to one of these state-of-the-art recent models, like Audio LDM or Audio Gen. And you get these amazing versions of these sounds that actually sound kind of like birds tweeting. And it's remarkable that we can do this. But when you listen to them, you also hear that they're pretty low quality. They're very noisy. They're not very clean. And I don't know about you, but this doesn't really inspire ideas for creative applications in me personally. Instead, in the world of sound design, we're often looking for things that evoke concepts. As Suzanne Chani, a famous sound designer, describes, bubbles don't make sound, but you can create the concept of a sound and you can make it seem real. And one of the ways that sound designers have traditionally done this is through tools called modular synthesizers. These are playable, tweakable interfaces that allow you to connect things together and turn knobs to create a wide variety of different sounds. So what we did is embedded this into a generative audio model setup. So hopefully you hear that these sounds are crisp and clear and don't have those problems that the other ones have, but they're also playable and tweakable.
Now, let me show you how we can interpolate these sounds, and we can go from a bird to a chainsaw to a helicopter while all the parameters move in real time. Now, with cheetah and syntax, we get the best of both worlds. We have a modular synthesizer that is tweakable, interpretable, and playable, and we have a generative model that is text-guided, it's high quality, and it's fast. Now, if you remember the examples that we played at the beginning, they are from large models, which are the state of the art, that have billions of parameters, large latent spaces. With cheetah, you can think about just 78. And these are things that we know. This is frequency, duration, attack, decay, then these are not just variables, these are knobs. Now, if we project all these knobs into a two-dimensional space, you can see how conceptually similar sounds, like gargling and boiling water, are close together, while others are far apart. We can also explore the boundaries and interpolate between them and travel in this space. We're excited about what CTEC and SynTech mean for creating and understanding sounds. Thank you.
Well, thank you all so much. That was a really thought-provoking and also inspiring opening session. And I'd like to have one more round of applause for all the students who, of course...